Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on a commander from Core Set 2021, Vito Throne of the Duskrows. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. Other ways you can help support the channel is my Patreon. Patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, and higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to that down in the description too. In fact, patrons got a chance to see this video earlier. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Vito is a 1-3 vampire cleric for 2 generic and 1 black. Being so cheap to cast means that we don't have to really worry that much about protecting him, since recasting him a couple of times per game won't really be an issue, especially in mono black. He has a triggered ability identical to Sanguine Bond, which is why he's one half of that infinite combo with Exquisite Blood in the command zone. This means that instead of having to play a deck where you'd need to tutor for both of these enchantments for the win, you only need to worry about getting Exquisite Blood. That being said, you can also win in a similar way with Blood Tribute, albeit with this one you'd only be able to take out one opponent. Since Vito is already a vampire, he's actually better for this combo than Sanguine Bond is. That being said, Vito isn't just one half of an infinite combo in the command zone. For 5 mana, you can give lifelink to all of your creatures until end of turn. This might seem overcosted for what it does, but when you consider that whenever you gain life, your opponents lose that much life, it's almost like giving your creatures double strike. In fact, it's even better than that, since you can attack one opponent to gain life and then target a different opponent to lose life. Even then, Whip of Erebos, which is also in the deck, can give lifelink to all of our creatures for less mana, and it's not until end of turn. It also has the added bonus of unearthing a creature for just 4 mana and tapping. We can also gain life via other methods. Blood Artist, Zulaput Korthborg, and Falconwrath Noble gain us life at the expense of opponent's life whenever creatures die. Although the effect isn't identical on each creature, the fact remains that we can still weaponize creatures dying as well as gaining us life in the process. Grey Merchant of Asphodel has the potential of taking this to the extreme thanks to this being a mono-black deck. If we're then able to sacrifice it or have it die somehow and then recover or reanimate it, we can continuously drain the entire table for life. Same goes with Malakir Blood Witch. While Gary depends on our devotion to black, the Blood Witch cares about how many vampires we control. This deck having a vampire sub-theme means that it should be more than enough to run the Blood Witch. Similar to Gary, being able to recur this effect can be quite draining to opponents. Sanctum Seeker is similar in the tribal sense since it triggers with vampires attacking. In this case, each opponent loses life so we can then target an opponent on the verge of death with Vito or an opponent we couldn't really attack directly. Soren Markov can drain a target for 2 points by increasing 2 loyalty. This is a great way to trigger the Vito Exquisite Blood combo as well as sniping any mana dorks or hate bears. His -3 is incredibly brutal in multiplayer EDH since it's potentially taking 30 life away from an opponent for just 6 mana. His ultimate can be pretty backbreaking, making this a solid inclusion in the deck, even though his inclusion is mostly for the first 2 abilities. Exsanguinate is the best life drain spell in the deck though. Not only will you gain thrice X life, but since you gained that much life, Vito can make any opponent lose that much life. So sinking a significant amount of mana in Exsanguinate can easily take out an opponent, if not the entire table. Alhammerit's Archive makes it so any life we gained is doubled. It also doubles the cards we draw apart from the first one in our draw step, and that's also taken advantage of in the deck, but we'll see that later on. Since weaponizing life gain is a theme of the deck, Aetherflux Reservoir is yet another way to instantly dispose of an opponent. Not only do we gain life by casting spells, but we can then sink life to kill off an opponent. With the amount of life we gain in this deck, this is relatively easy to pull off. Since the deck does have plenty of utility creatures that happen to be vampires, including Vito himself, it's quite simple to enhance that even further with the tribal sub-theme with the inclusion of a couple of cards. Cordial Vampire and Indulgent Aristocrat help in getting +1/+1 counters on our vampires. The latter also serves as a sacrifice outlet in case we want to sacrifice Grey Merchant of Asphodel or Malakir Blood Witch to then unearth with Whip of Erebos to potentially win the game. Drana Liberator of Malakir takes it a step further by putting a +1/+1 counter on all of our attackers regardless if they're vampires or not, although she does have to have been able to hit an opponent first. Fortunately, she is herself one, so she benefits from the tribal boons for vampires. Obelisk of Urd has the potential of needing no mana to cast, and it'll then give +2/+2 to all of our vampires when we choose that creature type for it. However, Coat of Arms is the best way to pump our vampires, though since it gives them +1/+1 for every other vampire on the battlefield. Be careful when playing this against other tribal decks though. That being said, it provides another viable win con since we can swing in with some vampires with lifelink, deal a ton of damage, and then use Vito to finish off any stragglers. We can also create a vampire each turn with Bloodline Keeper. With enough vampires, it can then transform into Lord of Lineage, which can also give a vampire per turn. These can also be used as sacrifice fodder, which also part of some engines in the deck. Additionally, it pumps our other vampires +2/+2, which is nothing to scoff at. so it definitely pulls its weight. Sorin Imperius Bloodlord is an obvious choice for Vampire Tribal since both his positive abilities are centered around vampires. His ultimate can also be used the moment he hits the battlefield, meaning that any vampire in our hand essentially costs only 3 mana to cast. This is great for those more expensive vampires in the deck. Speaking of casting vampires, Cavern of Souls, an auto-include in every tribal deck, is great to prevent Vito from getting countered as well as any other key vampire we want to cast like Malarka Bloodwitch, Sanctum Seeker, etc. Some tribal cards like Herald's Horn, Vanquisher's Banner, and Champion of Dusk help in providing some card advantage as well. The Horn reduces the cost of our vampires, and if we reveal a vampire from the top deck during our upkeep, we're essentially drawing 2 cards that turn. The Banner not only pumps our vampires, but we also draw a card whenever we cast one. Champion of Dusk is similar to Malarka Bloodwitch, but draws us cards at the cost of life for each vampire we control. With all the life we're gaining in a match, this isn't that big of an issue. Urza's Incubator doesn't provide card advantage, but like the Horn, it's helpful in reducing the cost of our vampires. A reduction of 2 generic is great since that makes Vito cost a single black mana or can also help in reducing the commander tax. We can also draw cards via more conventional methods like casting Night's Whisper, Read the Bones, or Live Fast when we're drawing 2 cards at the cost of 2 life. Read the Bones has the bonus of scrying 2 first, and the energy counters from Live Fast is unfortunately lost on in this deck. Succumb to Temptation also draws us 2 cards for 2 life but is an instant, so it's actually better than the former 3 spells. We can continue investing our life as card drawing resource with Necrologia, having the flexibility of us paying any amount of life for it. The only drawback is being able to cast it only during our end step. In this sense, it's similar to Necropotence, which is also in the deck. Necropotence is obviously vastly superior to Necrologia since we can activate it whenever we want, and it's not card draw, so it can also bypass any effects that wouldn't let us draw cards. It also costs triple black for that devotion. Speaking of which, Erebos God of the Dead and Erebos Bleak Hearted are more ways of turning life into card draw, but these do require paying mana. Although similar, the latter can only draw you cards when a creature you control dies, which is no biggie in this deck, especially since he has a built-in sacrifice outlet that also functions as a potential piece of removal, which we'll see more of soon enough. Argel's Bloodfast is similar to both Ereboses, but it can transform into Temple of Aklatsots, which is something we neither need nor desire in this deck. Dropping down to 5 life might be too dangerous unless we did it to take out an opponent with Aetherflux Reservoir. Similar life for draw is found on Dread Presence and Phyrexian Arena, which happen only on their respective triggers. However, even though the Nightmare can draw us a card, we can also drain life for it, meaning that it's also another simple way to trigger the Vito Exquisite Blood combo. Since the deck is running all 5 fetch lands, we can also trigger this at instant speed. So if we don't need the mana at that moment, we can use the fetch to get a swamp onto the battlefield when we need to trigger Dread Presence. Fear not though, we can still synergize giving life for cards with Vilas Broker of Blood. Whenever we lose life, we draw cards. So it's crazy how Vilas can make our fetch lands cantrip too. However, it's more busted when combined with Necropotence. We can essentially pay 1 life per card at instant speed and then get that same amount of cards in our hand at the end of our turn. Not only that, but Vilas also has a built-in way to weaponize life in potentially killing off other creatures. Again, we'll see some more removal effects further along in the video. Fortunately, not every card draw effect in the deck is detrimental to our health. Disciple of Bolas and Krob the Unredeemed turn creatures into card draw and life gain. Krob's ability is repeatable and also makes him bigger in the process, making him quite the beater as well. Liliana Dreadhorde General also has us drawing cards off of creatures dying with her static ability. All of her abilities are also relevant since she creates sacrifice fodder, has the table lose 3 creatures, and has a very oppressive ultimate. Viscera Sealer is a vampire that doesn't draw us cards per se, but is a cheap vampire with a free sacrifice outlet that can filter our draws. And even if not used for scrying, it can still benefit from the tribal buffs and serve to smash face. Beyond drawing deep into the deck, we can simply tutor for what we need with the namesake spells, Vampiric Tutor, Demonic Tutor, Grim Tutor, and Diabolic Tutor. Vampiric Tutor is clearly better cast at the end of the turn before yours or in response to a draw card effect. The life loss for Vampiric and Grim Tutor is negligible, so they're fine. Thanks to getting reprinted in M21, Grim Tutor is finally acquirable. Hopefully soon the same thing can happen with Cruel Tutor and Imperial Seal. Although digging deep through our deck will help us find the combo pieces for the instant victory of the engine pieces to maximize our efforts, we can't just let our opponents do their thing without interruption. Grave Pact and Dictate of Erebos are naturally included in this deck, but so is Butcher of Malakur for not only having a similar effect but for also being a vampire. It is quite costly to cast, but at least the deck has a lot of ways to generate a ton of mana, which we'll soon see, as well as Sorin being able to cheat it onto the battlefield. The deck has plenty of ways to sacrifice creatures, so these not only serve as a deterrent to not have our creatures killed, but we can also do double duty with our own deaths. An 0-1 the Ruined Sage also makes opponents sacrifice creatures, but it has to be a non-vampire creature. If we have any of those, we'd lose one of them, but at least we're getting more benefit for it than opponents will. Dark Imposter takes it further by exiling a target altogether. It might cost 6 to activate, but at least it gets a +1/+1 counter on it, as well as copying any activated abilities of exiled creatures. It's also a vampire, which is a bonus. Speaking of the bonuses of running vampires, Captivating Vampire is removal in the form of stealing. Not only does it pump all vampires +1/+1, but by tapping 5 vampires, you steal any creature and it becomes a vampire as well. If nothing else, then we can just wipe the board with Toxic Deluge, Damnation, or Kindred Dominance. Toxic Deluge has the benefit of bypassing Indestructible, but if our creatures are bigger, we might not even lose our board. Same with Kindred Dominance, we won't lose any of our vampires. Sure, any opponents with vampires will keep theirs as well, but odds are that we'll have way more vampires than they do. Either way, the deck's running Witch of the Moors in case we lose any crucial piece. Not only that, but we can also use the Witch to recover Gary or any other creature with an Enter the Battlefield triggered ability. We can sacrifice them for value and then potentially recover them to our hand with the Witch afterwards. Granted, we have to gain life that turn first, which is simple enough for this deck. Patriarch's Bidding can also help get the job done since it can be used to reanimate all of our vampires in our graveyard. If anyone had wiped the board, this is definitely a great way to quickly recover our board state, even if it's limited to just our vampires. Being mono black, the deck has plenty of ways to generate enough mana to be able to do what we want to do as we play. Sure, Soul Ring, Mana Crypt, and Ancient Tomb are included to try and get Veto out as quickly as possible, especially if we find Exquisite Blood early enough before our opponents are able to deal with it. But they also serve to activate cards like Cabal Coffers and Nykthos Shrine to Nyx. With how high the devotion to black is going to be, Nykthos will definitely tap for a lot of mana. The deck is running Urborg Tomb of Yawgmoth to help Cabal Coffers tap for even more mana. Fortunately, it's not that crucial in mono black deck since all basic lands are swamps, especially here since the deck's running 24 snow-covered swamps in case opponents are running anything that benefits us for it. Running so many basic swamps also helps Cabal Stronghold tap for a ton of mana. Although it's clearly a nerfed Cabal Coffers, is still decent in mono black decks since it taps for mana, thus not taking up a slot, unlike Cabal Coffer does. Thanks to having so many swamps, Urborg or no Urborg, Nirkana Revenant helps in them tapping for double the mana. Being a vampire that also has the Shade ability makes it a potential win con as well. Being able to sink a ton of mana into an unblocked Nirkana Revenant is another way to take an opponent out of the game. Bubbling Muck, the Black High Tide, also helps in generating a ton of mana with our swamps, but it only lasts until end of turn. However, cast before Exsanguinate can mean the difference between it winning us the game or just making us the immediate arch enemy. Similarly, Lake of the Dead takes advantage of our swamps. What's great about this card is that the swamp's sacrifice don't have to be untapped, so we can tap the swamp for mana before Lake of the Dead enters the battlefield. Same goes for the swamp we can sacrifice to its ability. This can be used to give our deck quite the boost. We can use this mana to sink into Westville Abbey if we need chum blockers in a pinch or sacrifice fodder. As a bonus, we can also transform the Abbey into Ormendal Profane Prince, an epic beater that also happens to have lifelink, something Veto loves for our creatures to have. It might not seem like a lot, but when transformed mid to late game, it could definitely make the difference in killing off an opponent. We can also get mana from the tokens created by Pawn of Ulamog, yet another vampire in the deck. Although the trigger is only for non-token creatures, it's fine since it'll trigger when we use creatures as sacrifice fodder or if they die from any other means. In any case, it also benefits from the tribal boons in the deck, so it can also be used as a beater. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Veto, Throne of the Duskrows. This is a very straightforward deck since it includes Veto's classic 2-card combos as well as a vampire sub-theme that's very easy to pilot. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am Demented Kirby, and happy brewing.